Hello. Did the chaos haven't done Lufenia yet, but about to do the challenge crest. Should have filmed the Wamuu challenge crest, but I didn't. Should be hitting cap consistently. I didn't think it was that many brave hits.
I didn't know that at all.
I read it as Dorn. Oh, Professor Game sent in $5 and wrote, "I'm drunk. I'm listening to a goat and an alien."
Oh, that's just stupid. I'll give you the world. Another night in New York.
That sounds about right. At least it's coming from your computer. You're not listening to that on the subway.
I was savage.
The duelist sent in 1 minute listening to Chris's voice.
Could have brought Garnet, but I don't want a challenge here. Probably should have did this LD, but it's all well. Probably should have did this LD at the beginning like you're supposed to, but oh well. Then I could have just HP plus a Brave plus White here. But oopsie on me.
Most people come clean. One bad apple spoils the bunch every time. Left after a due to air glue to the zip. What?
What?
I don't know.
Glued to the seat. How does that happen? Flower Guard has sent in $5 Australians. I haven't been to a con and want to go to one someday, but yeah, those stories make me not want to. Just to be careful if you do. Sir Barry sent in $5 saying, I'm a furry. I'm a furry that wears a skin suit to look like the TF2 spy. Also, tell Propane that we need to fumigate the basement tomorrow morning. Well, for his show, I mean, we definitely should. Blood Mark Mentor sent in $5 saying, oh god, I tuned into the rain first. What the hell are the last? What the hell are the last two streams?
Okay.
Laughing in the internet on the internet. Really nothing out of the usual. Just that we had a little more interaction these last few times. Spaceboy 92 sent in $10 saying, as a cosplayer during those Galop and Yowie paddle days, cons were a mixed bag.
Oh my god!
Comments into $5 saying, Asterisk, is it true that your grandma the one who cursed the Chicago Cubs? Also, not sure if you care, but Chris is bad. It's really funny what did it. I think it's the Freedom Group, right? I don't, what do you mean bad? Bodacious CNO sent in $2. Oh, you mean Chris is back, like he's not LARPing the Sonic Show anymore. Yeah. Bodacious CNO sent in $2.
Well, over 20, under 25 is not as good. Yeah, under 20 is good.
We got a bit more to go through. Just bear with me, people. Really, what there's in 499, honestly, the worst conventions to be in were the theater conventions.
I don't know.
What?
No, Danny.
And John enters with a camcorder. Not really appropriate at the moment there, bud. They stick a tube all the way up in there, warning. Some tugging. Way more painful than that. And they hand her over a bloody.
Gonna have to get her LD buff back up.
What are we doing this thing? She speaks with her therapist about it, for confirming that dreams can be manifestations of your emotions. The body and mind way of dealing with what happened. She considers that instead of it being about the stillbirth, knowing that they're looking at kids to adopt this weekend, perhaps it's about her not being ready to adopt yet. Beyond the trauma of losing her child,
want a free skill?
Struggles with an alcohol problem, divulging that she stopped by a wine shop the other night, but did resist the urge to go in. The doc encourages her that the key is not that she had the urge, but that she didn't get into it. She then goes to pick up her deaf daughter, Max, showing off a lovely little butterfly painting that she did for her.
That's not what happened, is it? That's not
the car behind her honking, and she reactively accelerates, almost smashing right into a
oh
truck.
Oh my god.
The light's still red, too. I don't know what that guy was honking about. At their quite luxurious house, Kate plays some piano. And hey, she's pretty good. Master Tango over here. She keeps getting interrupted by thugs.
I can't trust me.
Upset with her to stop as she's working, but then calms herself, apologizing, as her husband John and son Daniel pull up. She gets a startle from John in the bathroom and expresses to him the variety of emotions she's going through, all revolving around adopting a new daughter. Nervous, scared, excited, happy, the whole gamut, really. The last time that she talked,
I think that was worth missing the EX right there.
John telling her that she doesn't have to do this for him, but she says it's not for him, but that she wants to take the love she had for Jeff.
Plus terror, so yeah. I'm gonna try to terror lock him as long as I can.
All alone, painting, asking if he's back
Warp. And in order to really benefit from Warp, I'm gonna have to just brave attack with Aerith. If I can. I don't know.
What? Is that a little girl?
What?
Huh?
It don't look like her.
They're already smitten with her after this initial interaction. Abby brings out her folder that says that she's from Russia, but speaks English quite well, considering that she's only been in the States for 2 years. And she already has had some issues, as the family that brought her to America all died in a house fire. Poor Esther barely got out alive, concluding that she's been through a lot, but is an extraordinary girl. So they do decide to adopt Esther. Everyone all smiles. And she's picking up sign language already from Kate, teaching her how to do Max's name. She signs hello to Kate, noting that she's been practicing the whole way home. She next meets Grandma Barbara, giving her a little
bit of a
Kate's drinking must have really been. The couple will try to have a moment of intimacy, but they're intruded upon by Esther and Max, scared of the storm outside, and want to sleep in bed with them. Esther choosing to be right.
If he can't act with the bomb still go off,
it's time for Esther's first day of school.
We'll just have to find out.
Kate tries to tell her it's not really a school dress, her thinking she must be worried the kids will laugh at her, but reminds her what she said about there being nothing wrong with being different. She relents. Oh, you're right, telling her to have fun. Yet as expected, as soon as being introduced to the class, she's immediately made fun of. One girl, Brenda, joking, little Bo Peep called and wants her outfit back. Everyone erupting into guffaws. That's good. Later, Esther is pulling Max around in a sled over a frozen lake to Kate's worry, yelling that she knows better. Must be that whatever thing happened with Max occurred here. Meanwhile, Danny is firing off some paintballs at army figures. Then a pigeon lands, and he takes aim at it, pegging it and knocking it to the ground. He runs over, finding it still breathing as the girls join him. Esther grabs a rock, telling him it's his responsibility to put it out of its misery. Him crying, it was just an accident. But she's not so bothered, crushing it immediately with a rock. One of those signs of a serial killer thing, I think. She goes to her room to put away some laundry, seeing she's in progress of a painting of a building. And in a dresser, discovers a well-worn Bible jammed in the back of the drawer. She pulls out a photo of a man. Who's that guy? And quickly shoves it back in, worrying about being caught. Esther peeking out after she leaves. At school, Danny is clearly growing more animosity towards his new sister. As she walks by, he knocks the books out of her hands. And Brenda doubles down on this, grabbing her Bible and calling her a Jesus freak. Esther tries to snatch it back, but she doesn't let go, ending up sending papers flying everywhere. Brenda grabs at her ribbon, calling it her
this
little
way,
bottle.
Esther
freaks, screaming bloody murder. Yeah, jeez, don't touch the ribbons, I guess. Kate and Esther have a piano lesson, encouraging that she did well. But Esther puffs grumpily, Esther asks about Jessica, as Max talks about her, and takes her out to a memorial plaque in the garden. They scattered her ashes here, so as long as this plant grows, part of her will live on inside it. A single tear rolling down Esther's face. She would have been lucky, she says, JP, you're a great mom. Kate gives her a kiss and big hug, thanking her for saying that. Remember what Kate said at the beginning. She wanted to take that love she had for Jessica and to give it to someone who deserved it. And hey, so far appears to be going just as she hoped. John comes home later in a quite frisky mood, putting the moves on her in the kitchen. She's hesitant that they'll get caught, and yep, right when they get down to humping, they're spotted by Esther staring at them coldly. She comes in to talk about it, trying to explain that grown-ups do things children aren't supposed to see. Esther interrupting, I know, they fuck, in a casual tone. Ooh, seems that she knows more than the average 9-year-old in that sense. She discusses this with John. Her concern that she knew what she meant, not just something that she overheard, suggesting to take her to the train, as they don't really know much about her. But he brushes it all off as just being
a shrink.
A mom comes up and awkwardly hits on John, chuckling that she has a favor to ask, while Esther is preoccupied with her school bully, staring daggers at her. Brenda seeing that she isn't in the swing and looks worried that Esther is going to pop up somewhere while she tries to play. And that is what happens. Approaching the slide, Esther appears, screaming, and pushes her off, her legs snapping on impact as she tumbles down. The whole thing witnessed by Max. Don questions her about what happened.
Don asks, that's a how you gonna break your leg.
And when asking Max, he actually covers her, Danny annoyed by her eating, telling her to just eat normal, demanding her to send her back to wherever she belongs. Honestly, I'm not exactly sure what he has a problem with here. It looks like pretty normal eating to me, but, well, that steak is definitely overcooked. I mean, I don't know if that's the problem. He's asked to apologize to his sister, getting furious. He pounds on the table.
Due to his behavior, his dad locks up his corner. I don't know the big deal.
Really ripping it on the piano. Surprised to see Esther, a confused Kate asks, you didn't tell me you knew how to play. She corrects, no, I didn't. You just offered me to teach, and I accepted. So you were just pretending? Esther shrugging, I don't know, I thought you'd like it. Frustrating having a son not interested in music and a daughter who can't hear. And we're starting to see cracks in her overall angelic veneer, getting a glimpse at who Esther really is at her core. She brings up the line to John, yet he again excuses it away. She just wants to spend time with you. So we're just going to buy everything she says. Oh yeah, what about him and Joyce? Esther said that he was hitting on her, then downplaying that she just needed him to move a chair, but blew her off. Why didn't you tell me, she interrogates, saying that he was worried about how she would react. And now we know why she would be so concerned, huffing that it's been 10 years, meaning that he must have had an affair at some point.
Warp, I don't think Warp is on, so...
Not the perfect little family after all, lots of stuff starting to come out now. He gets irritated, so we can't talk about your mistakes. Only mine, huh? She yells she was sick, while he just wanted to be with someone else. He retorts that she put their child's life in danger. Someone drinking, probably things getting quite heated, she asks for satisfaction. Seal. Esther Quayle comforts her, telling her, not to worry, my baby sister. I love you. Ooh, boy, some serious manipulation going on here. Danny happens upon the girls crawling out of the treehouse and hides nearby, just missing Esther's glance. But it seems that she did spot him after all, waking him up later with a box cutter to the throat.
100.
To know what he saw. He swears that he just saw the two of them leave, and two promises not
and his to And his bomb should make up for the damage Aerith didn't do.
Saw it when you were driving up earlier. No? Okay. The cops arrive on the scene, discovering discovering her body, and John is befuddled. Who would do this? Yeah, who do you think, John? Come on now, bud, wake up. There's obviously no question at this point, seeing Esther in her room, flipping her recorder and black light on and off. When it comes on, her seemingly normal pictures become much more terrifying, filled with things like people dying and on fire. Fade does a Googler into her potential mental conditions, finding evidence that backs up Esther possibly being a master manipulator. Yet ever doubtful John still doesn't believe her. He suggests getting some help for the kids, but she says she doesn't need it. Abby was right about her suspicions. She agrees to at least try to contact her rusty orphanage as a start. She makes the call, and oddly, they have no record of her whatsoever. Kate, on the way to school, takes an opportunity with her other kids to interrogate about Esther, asking how they're getting along with her. The kids are mortified of her, so they don't admit anything about the truth, saying they're getting along just fine. As Esther's true purpose starts to come into focus, painting alone with John, she tells him she likes it when it's just the two of us, and has waited so long for
the guy to like him. Esther
bemoans that yes, he doesn't really love her. It's hard to be part of a child. But John assures her that she is a part of the family, and suggests that she do something to show mommy how she feels. Esther beaming, what a great idea! The gift she presents is one designed to further dig at Kate's flowers that she picked from Jessica's plant, causing Kate to get emotional, grabbing her arm angrily, screaming, what did you do? And John comes in to break things up, Kate insisting she knows exactly what she did, and did it on purpose. But he blames himself for the suggestion, still thinking she's innocent. Kate has a mournful cry in the garden over Jessica's plant, all but decimated to nothing. In a way, being forced to say goodbye permanently to Jess, thanks to Esther's doing. As Esther goes further to paint her new mommy as a villain, she sticks her arm in a vise and tightens it until it snaps the bone protruding out. Yuch! Making it obviously look like Kate injured her much more than she did. She puts a plan into action, yelling for her daddy, and upon inspection of her fresh wound, deems that she needs to go to the hospital. Kate shows up later to the sight of John tucking her in, rolling her eyes in disgust. You broke her arm, he accuses, but she defends that she didn't even grab her that hard. She seems to finally give in to her vice of alcohol, purchasing two bottles at the store, but telling the guy it's just for a dinner party. But it's not like that guy even knows or cares, you know what I mean? The excuse is more for her than anyone else. She pours a big old glass, staring it down, but still
smiling, and decides to pour it out after all.
The public narrative continues to paint Kate as the culprit here, including Esther
pouring
the
empty
bottles in her hiding space. Although Kate remembers with certainty but the doc thinks that it's really her behind all the problems, thinking her drinking is really the problem at play here. She admits to drinking one of the bottles, but otherwise hasn't had a drink in a year. But no one is believing her at this point. And John, as usual, isn't on her side either, giving her the ultimatum of...
Seems like a frame buff got pushed off.
In 1 week, this is all watched by a teary-eyed Max. Knowing if he just told the truth, he could resolve this. But Esther whispers a sinister warning. If you tell, I'll shoot mommy. Essentially, Esther's taken a power hold over the house in various ways.
I think it was Arab's buff.
...expose Esther's true nature, sneaking into his sister's room, and gets the truth about the car crash from her, and shows him drawings that she's done of Abby's death. She reveals the bad things were all... promising everything's gonna be okay. He's gonna get the stuff back, and
it's the most important one, the last one that delays too. That sucks.
It is, huh? I don't know. Huh? What's wrong?
She warns that she won't let her hurt her children, and the girl digs a knife in further, bringing up Kate's big past mistake that they talked about a little bit. She left Max in the lake and passed out drunk. John was the one who saved her, and if it wasn't for him, she would probably be in jail and not should be dead, having learned all of the details from her diary. She then goes in search of Esther's Bible, finding it jammed into a stuffed animal for hiding, discovering inside several pictures.
I mean, after this, he respawns the notes, too.
...blazoned with a Sarn Institute logo. She manages to find a number for the place, and luckily an employee there speaks English. She asks about a child coming from there, but he says that that's not possible, as they're not actually an orphanage, but in fact a mental hospital. Uh-oh! Danny continues his attempt
what
to dispatch Esther, breaking into the treehouse, and checks the stash spot, but it's empty. She enters with all of the evidence. Looking for this, she implicates Max again, as she's just as guilty as her. Always better to burn the evidence, she scowls, throwing some lighter fluid on it and tosses a match. She sprays more right at him, the fire really getting going now. She then locks him inside as the fire continues.
They're very specific.
And is sending the SAR Institute a picture of her. Danny shimmies out onto the roof. He slides off the side, landing on a beam, clutching on his
arm. I don't know.
Finally notices the big ass fire going on in the backyard. Esther goes for a rock to finish him off, and it's Max who pushes her away, seeing Kate not too far behind.
Everyone, what you mean? I don't know, huh? I don't know. I don't know.
She rightfully asserts that it was either Esther or Daniel that started the fire. Yet he still wants her. She's exhausted from trying to convince him that
she's obviously right.
I don't know.
I guess. Because I got Terra and Warp, right? I think it does Terra and Warp. It's EX. No, it just does Terra, but I got Warp, though. So, LD right here. Water, lightning, earth, wind, ice, fire, and I think that's it. Okay, that's good. I think scale 1 is Warp, and just the scale 2 is Terror. I'm wrong. Just this easy. Probably could do it with Garland. I mean Garnett, but it would be difficult.
Bougie Wack. Oh no.